Hi, I'm Jamie Farr. Welcome to the MASH 4077 and the setting of one of the most popular TV series of all time, MASH. Well, this is where the set used to be. I spent a lot of time in these hills. I can recall the mess tent, the captain's tent, the latrine. Ah, what great memories. Well, tonight, we're going to relive those memories on the making of MASH. I would have loved to have been there for the first episode, but I didn't make my entrance till show number 7. I always say, better late than never. So let's go back in time and go behind the scenes with the men and women who created this television giant, the making of MASH.
The year was 1972. Fighting continued in Vietnam, and the search for peace with honor was still underway. America was being torn with anti-war demonstrations, and Richard Nixon would soon clobber George McGovern at the polls. In Hollywood, a small group of talented people was preparing to launch its own anti-war effort, disguised as a comedy. MASH is an acknowledged television classic, perhaps the best series ever, certainly one of the few to realize the potential of the medium. During the next 90 minutes, you'll have the opportunity to find out how they do it as we talk with and watch the people responsible for making MASH.
I don't hear nothing.
Wait for it.
We're recreating a time of suffering and joy and revelation that happened to real people at a real time. We know what they went through, and we're, in a way, going through what they went through. And we can't ignore that. We can't be casual in the face of that. This is not a sitcom.
MASH was a very personal show. It represents the points of view of several key people. I don't think there'll ever be another show like it until there is a confluence, again, of a certain number of people who are able to translate their feelings about the world as successfully as we did, however immodest that sounds.
A CBS network exec in the first year at lunch said to Larry and I, someday I'll sit down with you guys and show you how you have screwed up MASH.
I think probably if MASH were a pilot today, you couldn't sell it.
The word boom is your cue, and it comes immediately after action. It goes approximately action, boom. So be listening for both words. I'll be in the Johnson.
Inside Stage 9 on the 20th Century Fox lot in Los Angeles is unique in television history. A group of people with something serious to say were given an opportunity to say it. And to the credit of both CBS and Fox, there was little interference with the creative process. From the beginning, the basic humanity and intelligence of the show's creators was allowed to surface, and it was coupled with a real sense of purpose.
We were not unmindful of what a series can say, that the thesis was dealt with the destructiveness, the wastefulness of war.
And while they recognized the opportunity they had, there was a wariness that the business of television could play havoc with their intent.
I was afraid that we would treat the war, or not we, but that the war would be treated by the writers and the production staff as just a background, a backdrop for lighthearted hijinks at the front. And I didn't want to be part of that. I wanted to show that the war was a bad place to be, that people got hurt in war, and that it was not the occasion of hilarity. The way people reacted to it might be hilarious.
Do I understand that the priest of this outfit has just won a weekend with a nurse in Tokyo?
It's a prayer come true.
Who are you?
Captain Benjamin Franklin Pierce. Who are you, Sarge?
What do you think this star means?
You're Tinkerbell?
This is Brigadier General Hammond, Chief Medical Officer of the Soul Sector.
Oh, hi.
Which one here's McIntyre?
Yup.
You and Pierce are both under arrest.
I'd like to get a second opinion on that.
The mummy strikes.
Those two, they're ruining this war for all of us.
Get your MPs, Henry. On the double.
Henry?
You two are going to be court-martialed.
In Tokyo? San Francisco?
Now get moving. You're under arrest.
Oh, and I'm afraid we can't do that, General.
No.
That's a good idea, though.
I like it.
The same thing in his place.
Sure. We can't do it.
You can't do what?
Listen.
What?
Wait for it.
Those helicopters you're about to hear are going to be filled with Canadians who went to a different party tonight. Without us, a lot of those kids are not getting home from that party.
Attention, all personnel, report immediately to admitting ward and operating room.
Now, General, look. Hey, you can put us in the clink after. But right now, we got a job to do, and we're a little short-handed around here, and we can use all the help we can get.
Okay. David, Mr. Ogden Stiers, I'm going to reinforce. What is your first line? Let me just rehearse with you and him.
In 1975, when MASH became the first half-hour comedy series to win the prestigious George Foster Peabody Award, the judges cited the show as an example of television of high purpose. What you discover as you watch this ensemble making MASH is that their sense of purpose has never been lost. Its expression comes from this close-knit group of producers, writers, and actors who interpret the who, what, and why of MASH's characters. And it's their understanding of these characters that makes MASH work so well and say so much.
What are these guys doing, running around in circles? I've got entry wounds coming from three different angles.
It was a duck shoot. It seems when the order to retreat came down, one battalion commander decided his men should stay and fight a little longer. HQ calls that aggressive. I call it damn reckless.
Was MASH really about Korea or was it really about Vietnam?
Both. It was, more about Vietnam, I think, than people realize. I think the fact that it was a contemporary event with Vietnam gave meaning to the show.
While the network displayed the typical sort of fears about language and permissiveness to a certain degree, they were always very supportive about the series politically. There was never any attempt to say, let's tone it down in terms of criticizing the military, the government. They knew what we were up to very quickly and never challenged that.
MASH is the kind of show that never would have sold had it not been a film and a successful film. You'd never been able to go into a network and persuade them that you could have a comedy in an operating room in the middle of a war.
I think we're somewhat different from the movie, but I am grateful for what Altman did in the movie. He gave us a visual style, and he gave us a setting and a springboard, more than a springboard of characters, but at least that. We couldn't do this quite the way we do it, unless he had done the movie the way he did it.
Doesn't anybody in this outfit ever go to sleep?
Only on duty, sir.
Of course, there are certain obvious things that we could not do in a series that you can do in a feature. We could not be as explicit visually, vocally. We could not be as profane.
Why don't we go back to number one?
He wants another two.
And maybe we could make this pull out and swing around much, much slower.
We were discouraged from getting into the OR, the operating room, at all at first, and then they hoped that we would use restraint.
Okay, roll it, Will.
14 ticked off.
Speed, Mark.
Michael,
to
your left.
To my left.
Okay, ready. Action.
Nice work, Doctor. Looks like a perfect fit. Don't put any tension on the graft.
Got you. And I forgot my line.
Oh, I can't work under these circumstances. I'm sorry.
Would you like us to write it on the sponge with eyebrow pencil?
Hey!
Settle down.
Right.
Rolling.
Quiet.
airplane, oh, sure. Wouldn't you know it? I'm all set to go. Would have been great. Yeah. The goddamn plane has to come along. You dirty bastards.
And of course, the OR in the series is not nearly as vivid as the OR in the film. But we realize that these men had to be heroes. They had to justify themselves in the operating room. You had to go in there. You had to fulfill that experience in order to balance the show.
Rolling.
Thanks, Jiggs.
Perfect.
Action.
Action.
Nice work, Doctor. Looks like a perfect fit. Don't put any tension on the graft.
Gotcha. Damn clever of the Lord to equip each of us with his own set of spare parts. Need another suture, Margaret. More tantalum here.
For producer Gene Reynolds, the potential of MASH began to be realized early in the first year. It happened with an episode titled Sometimes You Hear the Bullet.
It was the first show in which somebody really close to Hawkeye died.
Tommy!
You're a beautiful sight.
What are you doing here?
What am I doing here? I'm an American soldier. I'm one of the good guys.
Henry, I want you to meet one of my best friends, Tommy Gillis. Tommy Henry Blake.
Henry, you're a beautiful sight.
How's going, Tommy?
It affected Hawkeye very strongly. And I think that the tone of that show was more serious and more touching than anything we had done. Really touched the viewer more.
I give you a kiss, but I can't lift my hat.
You just get my mask, Icky.
He's had 10 milligrams of morphine. Pressure 80 over 50 and faints.
Give me some more negative blood here, quick. Blood's for me. I'm anemic. Henry, I need your help.
60. I've got the aorta. Give me some retraction and suction.
Father Mulcahy.
I can't get a pressure. I've lost the pulse.
I'm going to open the chest. Give me a knife. I said, give me a knife.
Pierce. Go help McIntyre.
I think that exemplified the finest possible work we could do because it contained, along with the comedy, which is obvious and the staple of the show, it contained an element of horror.
The people at the network said, what is this, a comedy or a tragedy? What are you doing here? They were afraid the audience wouldn't accept it.
They did attempt to argue us out of that that approach. I think they felt that we were going to make the series too heavy, but we stuck by our guns.
I've watched guys die almost every day. Why didn't they ever cry for them?
Because you're a doctor.
The hell does that mean?
I don't know. If I had the answer, I'd be at the Mayo Clinic. Does this place look like the Mayo Clinic? Look, all I know is what they taught me at command school. There are certain rules about a war. And rule number one is young men die. And rule number two is doctors can't change rule number one.
I'm still with the young lady. She's over here.
It didn't take long for MASH to establish itself as a critical success in that first season. The ratings were another matter.
Chris in there will scream, which lets you know she's about to burst into sight. Okay. Right on.
You want a cookie?
Yeah, I'll take one, thanks.
There you are, sir.
And action!
And since the ratings were not good in the beginning, it helped to have friends in high places.
Okay, come on, take it easy, slugger. It's time for Betty Bye.
The first year was a shakedown cruise for MASH. Characters were being established and defined.
Broken field run there, crazy legs.
Gelbart and Reynolds were experimenting with formats and styles.
I call you Rita after my favorite movie star.
One format they settled on was the letter home. In MASH's first 8 years, there have been many of these, but the first was a show called Dear Dad, written by Gelbart.
After seeing three or four or five or however many we did, it was my wife who said to me, The one thing I don't really like about the show is the concentration on one story every week. It seems as though that's the only thing going on in the camp, whereas not only in the camp but anywhere else in the world, a lot of things are happening all at once. And so I took that as kind of a challenge and worked out the idea for the letter. I think the pilot episode starts with Hawkeye saying, Dear Dad, as I recall. So that notion was planted a bit earlier, even though I didn't know I'd pick it up later. But that was the idea, to give it life, to give the camp life, to see a lot of things happening rather than the one sort of 25-minute situation that would have to pay off.
And in that first season, just as they were discovering formats, they were discovering characters.
Hope! Friend or foe?
In a show called Chief Surgeon Who, we meet Corporal Max Klinger, a creation of Larry Gelbart's fertile mind.
Corporal Klinger, isn't it?
Right.
Still trying to get out on a psycho, ain't clear? Well, I can tell you, it'll take a lot more than this.
Then I'll just have to keep trying, Mary.
The inspiration was really Lenny Bruce, who dressed as a wave when he was in the Navy, trying to get out. And Gene said, when he read the script, Jamie Farr, I mean, bang, there was no thinking, it was just reflex. He just saw him, knew him. I said, who is it? He said, you'll see, you'll see.
And this is the outfit that made it all possible. This is a wax outfit. I don't know where the skirt is.
No, this is underneath.
It's underneath, yeah.
I didn't get this part because of my legs. We shot his scene with Sorrel Brook, a visiting general. I played the character the way the director had suggested. And when Gene and I saw the dailies, we were horrified because he'd been told to play it in a very stereotypical, swishy, fag way.
But they called me back and they said, you know, we didn't think that this character could sustain throughout the series or even in this one episode by doing this. So I just played it straight.
Please, Colonel, I won't smile at him or say I'm pregnant or anything.
All right, I'll tell you what. I'll give you 3 days R&R in Tokyo. You leave before Big Mac arrives, okay?
What good is that? He'll be here and I'll be there.
Well, it's either that or put you under tent arrest, tied to a bedpost if we have to. And I'd hate to do that, Klinger.
I worked so very hard for this, sir.
Easy guy.
It hasn't been easy, smiling through the makeup.
I'm sorry, Klinger.
Better dismiss me, sir, before my mascara starts.
And I always looked upon Klinger as the graphic way of saying the war stinks.
Put your mind at ease, sir. We gypsies have ways of finding things out.
Oh, that's right. You guys have crystal balls.
Cards. Concentrate with me, sir.
Being filmed, you're struck by the fact that everyone actually enjoys what they're doing, both cast and crew. Fact is, there's no way they could put so much energy into it, rehearsal after rehearsal and take after take, if they didn't enjoy it and enjoy each other. While Dominic Palmer, the director of photography in the 7th, 8th, and 9th seasons, is lighting the scene, the cast stays inside Stage 9. Unlike most other shows, no one hides in his dressing room waiting for someone to come get the star.
Somebody on that junior?
Yeah.
Turn it to the right.
Even the extras and stand-ins, many of whom have been with MASH from the start, will tell you that the MASH set is different, more relaxed, more humane. Kelly Nakahara, Nurse Kelly.
I worked 1,000 other shows, and on any other show that you go in from day one, the set is automatically tense. They're tense from day one, they're upset from day one, they are screaming at you from day one. To have a tense day on this set occurs, but it is the occasion. It's not the usual thing.
She's a beautiful girl.
See?
And that mood, that feeling, carries over onto the set. Everyone knows they're working on the best show in town. And they want it to stay that way, no matter what it takes.
Never hit me.
I will.
Sleep it, Bill. Take it with the lady.
Action, boom.
I've never been in a situation like this, and I'm in awe of the fact that from the first day I came here, the people are interested in making it better.
Do we have enough blood on the hands?
I'm not telling you that doesn't happen anywhere in the industry, but it has been my experience that this is the only place that it happens.
Right on boom, the flash happened. Who's going to yell boom?
Me. The flash should be a little ahead.
Yeah, well, it would be enough of a head if everybody starts it. Because the guy hits the flash, and by the time these things
everybody
get down...
Please, what? Quiet down. We're on a bell.
Mark. See? Settle, please. Action! Boom!
Cut.
Got it.
How's that look?
Superb.
Looks good from here.
I think it
came right so close to you, Bob.
Well, do we got it?
Yeah, look at this.
Print the thing.
There's no question that MASH is unique in the annals of television. But Alan Alda gives credit for what they can do now to some of those shows that have gone before.
I think Mary Tyler Moore opened the door for behavioral comedy, and All in the Family allowed you to deal with subjects that were not allowable before that, like death and racism and so on. So we really had the door open to us.
Rolling.
Could MASH be done three-camera, film, or tape in front of a studio audience such as Mary Tyler Moore or All in the Family?
11 Baker Tacoire.
Settle, well, it could be, but it wouldn't be the same show. I wouldn't want to do it that way. What you get in All in the Family, and I'm not knocking All in the Family, but it's a whole other experience for the audience.
Anybody hurt?
And the whole effect is one of taking a picture of a stage play.
Besides me?
If we did that, instead of seeing Colonel Potter and Margaret Houlihan standing in an operating room in Weijiangbu in 1952, you would see them in a room in Burbank making people laugh 50 feet away from them.
Action.
It wouldn't allow us to do some of the things that we do. Some of this feeling that we get from time to time of actually being in the place.
Hold the tissue together while I get this needle through. Okay. Okay, good.
Good. Now, Snow, let's switch hands.
Yes.
We tend not to do great subjects. We deal with more people-oriented stories, I think.
Hawk, you're looking at a guy that fell off the Fidelity wagon.
I thought I heard a thump sometime last night.
I'm miserable.
I'm a happily married man. Not like Frank Burns is happy because his wife owns real estate. I adore my wife and my kid and my marriage.
I know.
I don't like being unfaithful. I'm not looking around. I'm lucky to have what I've got.
You're right. You are lucky.
God help me.
BJ, you stumbled last night, that's all. You were helping somebody and it got out of hand. You made a mistake.
I sure did.
What's that?
I'm writing Peg about it.
Wrong, wrong, wrong. Don't be an idiot.
An interesting thing to investigate there was falling off the Fidelity wagon and then dealing with the consequences of it. It looked like you look at any character and you see what holds the character together, and then you say, well, what if that security blanket, what if that character is somehow challenged or turned a little bit, confused, trips, stumbles, what would happen?
I know how you feel. You feel guilty. But you're blaming me.
No, I'm not. I'm blaming myself.
Only partly. Look, I get your anger every time I come near you. I don't need it.
Carrie, I'm sorry, but you know what happened? I got this enormous attack of the guilts. I've never done that before. I'm hopelessly, passionately in love with my wife.
What's wrong with that?
I don't want to mess that up. I feel like I've betrayed her.
Why? Because you were kind and considerate and sweet to me? Because I was in despair one night and you helped me through it? Are you ashamed of it?
No, of course not, but there was more to it than that.
We didn't plan that. We're still human beings, you know, no matter how hard we try not to be.
Yes, I know. And I'm still afraid.
Of what?
Of you.
From the beginning, MASH has been a study in characters responding to each other, the situations.
For little boys and girls to behave like
individual characters, their motivations, their feelings, background and style are very much the concern of the writers and producers as they develop MASH scripts. And in the history of MASH, perhaps no character has gone through as many changes as Major Margaret Hot Lips Houlihan, played by Loretta Swift.
Is she a real person to you?
Yes. Yes, I believe in her. I think that's almost a prerequisite to playing any role. You must really believe in that person. And you must like them. You must find something about them that you like about them.
Did either of you ever kiss Frank?
Not me. How about you?
I was hoping maybe this New Year's Eve.
I probably shouldn't be telling you this. But Frank Burns is a lipless wonder.
Come on now, down the hatch.
Ow! What was that?
Load a B1. Get you on your feet again.
And I didn't get you anything.
Place and Linda Bloodworth. And Gene Reynolds called them and commissioned them to do a script for Margaret, particularly. And the three of us sat down and lost our voices. We talked for at least 6 hours and went back into her past, her background, her childhood, and really thrashed it out so that we knew exactly what was making this woman tick.
We were in training together. She married a doctor I turned down. And now she has a beautiful home with a swimming pool, two adorable children, two-car garage. Oh, Frank, it all could have been mine. That could have been me.
That house must have run $40,000.
45? I'd have loved him if I'd have known.
So there were a lot of meaningful things that came out in the episode, as well as its being so comedic.
I have nothing. Nothing.
Well, am I nothing, Margaret?
Your government issue, Frank. You came with my mess kit and my khaki girdle.
So much for Frank Burns.
And after you're home, I'll only be a smile on your face your wife won't understand.
Now, a major breakthrough was an episode that was written for me called The Nurses, in which Margaret has a confrontation with the nurses. And she is finally allowed to reveal what a lonely woman she is and how difficult it is to be in charge and to be in command. And we were allowed to see for the first time that she was really a very vulnerable, lonely woman. And it never fails to touch me because it was so meaningful for, again, her evolution.
What did she say to the nurses? Just do one sentence.
She says, do you know what it's like to pass by your tent and hear you laughing and joking and know that I'm not welcome? Why, you never even invited me in for a lousy cup of coffee.
Did you ever show me any kind of friendship? Ask my help with a personal problem? Include me in one of your little bull sessions? Can you imagine what it feels like to walk by this tent and hear you laughing and know I'm not welcome? Did you ever offer me a lousy cup of coffee?
Margaret, prepare to amputate.
Isn't there any chance we can reconstruct?
The artery's gone. I can't. I haven't got any time. If I save this leg, I lose that life.
By the third season, MASH and its characters had become established as part of Americana. Then one of the characters wanted to leave. McLean Stevenson was looking for his own show, and it was up to Gelbart and Reynolds to find a way for him to bow out.
I'm going home?
You got all your points. They're discharging you.
Discharged?
We were losing an actor, a very important character, really. And it seemed to me that we could make a very telling point.
Take it easy, will you, Frank?
We didn't want Henry Blake going back to Bloomington, Illinois, and going back to the country club and the brown and white shoes, because a lot of guys didn't get back to Bloomington.
People really do get taken out in a war. They just disappear. They're standing next to you 1 minute, and the next minute they're gone.
And so we killed them.
Radar, put a mask on.
If that's my discharge, give it to me straight. I can take it.
I have a message. Lieutenant Carroll, Henry Blake's plane was shot down over the Sea of Japan. It spun in. There were no survivors.
Well, the letters began to come in, and some of them, many of them, were very hostile. And they said, how dare you? You were watching a situation comedy, and we don't expect to get upset like that. You know, my son, my daughter cried when she saw that show.
You sucked us in. We thought this was a comedy show, and then you hit us with this tragedy. Cheap, exploitative. No, say it isn't so. You're wrong. We got a cable from Henry Blake. He landed on the coast of Texas. Phone calls from people. Some people understanding what we did and approving.
Larry and I sat down and began answering these letters by writing letters and explaining what the point was, that we wanted to illustrate the wastefulness of war.
I hand wrote 300 or 400 replies because if they felt that involved, then I owed him an explanation.
Finally, the letters were so great that we wrote a form letter, had it mimeographed, and then all we did was sign, and that took an enormous amount of time. I'm sure it was 1,000 letters that Larry and I answered explaining that.
The network was concerned.
The network despised it. They didn't like it. As a matter of fact, on one occasion in reruns, they cut off that scene.
And Fox was concerned. They thought we were doing something that one just doesn't do in a comedy series.
Tonight, if we turned on the set, we would see 15 people knocked off. They don't complain about that because it is unfelt. It is unfelt violence. It's unfelt trauma. And that's not good. I think that if there is such a thing as the loss of life, there should be some connection. And we did make a connection. It was a surprise. It was somebody they loved. They didn't expect it, but it made the point that people like Henry Blake are lost in war.
Nothing ever looks on television as grimy and as painful as it really is in life. And we don't show the wounded screaming in pain the way they do in real life. Out of sensitivity for the audience. But sometimes I think the audience should be given a little taste of what we're dealing with. Otherwise, we'll be doing what we said we weren't going to do that night before we started filming.
He survived. But what might have been a problem was treated as an opportunity. Burt Metcalf originally joined MASH to help Gene Reynolds cast the show. He's now executive producer.
Well, the cast defections have ultimately worked to our great advantage. That does not mean that McLean Stevenson was not as good as Harry Morgan, or that any of the people who have been replaced were replaced by people who are better. They've all been wonderful. But merely the fact that an actor left and we had to bring in somebody new changed the chemistry of the show, changed the whole relationship between that character and all the others, and enabled us to generate a lot of new stories.
McLean Stevenson's replacement was found working as a guest star in a scene with McLean Stevenson. Enter Harry Morgan, who had to be busted from crazy general to career army colonel in order to take command of the 4077th.
What have we here?
Oh, that's an old tongue depressor, General. Sir?
It's military equipment. You wouldn't carelessly throw away a used rifle, would you?
Well, I don't know, sir.
This can be cleaned up and used again. Waste.
Well, now, you see, General, that's full of germs. I don't even know if you can sterilize wood.
Let me put it to you this way. Have you ever seen a bird get blood poisoning from a white picket fence?
Well, I know so little about birds, sir. My mother's canary had bronchitis.
It was Waste defeated Hannibal at the Battle of Zama. He was a darkie, you know. What's that over there, Colonel?
Officer's quarters, sir.
And there?
That's our four-place latrine, sir.
Good thinking. The men can encourage each other.
What makes this show different? It's probably an overworked word, but I think what makes this show different is chemistry. We've got 7 people now. We used to have 8. Gary's left us. But you've got people who have love for one another. I mean, honestly, beyond that, affection. They get joy out of playing with one another, and we all respect one another, and I think that's the answer. That's the answer as far as the actors are concerned. That's a very extremely rare thing, particularly when you think of how many changes have been made in the cast of MASH.
Then we got down to the last bottle. This very bottle here. Anybody know what a tontine is?
Don't tell him.
It's a new gum.
Give that man a kick in the air.
Why is there no clash of egos? I think basically it's because everybody is a professional. There isn't any one of the members of our cast who you know, walked off of a bus stop and came in, and Hollywood said, here you are, you're a star in a hit television series. Everybody is a professional. And we all come here with good working habits.
Any of you know what a tontine is?
Yes. Tontine is a pledge.
Give that man a cheroot.
And what did it take to film this scene? Almost 6 hours.
We saved this bottle.
It was shot seven times, each time the camera focusing on a different combination of actors. And the emotional energy that went into the last take was just as intense as the energy put into the first.
For good or bad, you're looking at the last survivor of the group. I got the job when Gretzky passed away in Tokyo. He had the bottle sent here, God rest his soul.
Thank God I was wrong.
Colonel, we thought you were sick.
I was sick. I feel that Harry brought a lot of nuances that brought it up. It became more than the words. I have very strong feelings of affection for the character of Potter. He's like everybody's father, and I wanted to write something very good for him, because I felt this is the show spotlighted the character, spotlighted a side of the character that you don't normally get to see. In a way, kind of a summing up of his life as a soldier.
As I recall, it was mighty smooth in 17. Just one thing, I'd like to make the first toast solo to my old buddies. Here's to you, boys. To Ryan, who died in WW1. The war to end all wars. To G... Shit. Dead.
And what was going through Mike Farrell's mind at that moment?
How much I love the man. How stunned I am by the fact that we can say these things, portray this kind of real human emotion that's going to go out and be seen and shared by millions and millions of people. By the sort of revalidation of the essential statement of the value of humanity. And by how incredibly lucky I am to be here.
Major Burns.
That's not an audience laughing. It's a laughing machine. Laugh tracks are a standard network requirement on comedy shows, a requirement that Gelbart and Reynolds fought from the beginning. In the fourth year, CBS seriously considered their request to do away with it.
You're two and two more.
Pierce, you're in very deep trouble.
I don't think so. I can beat a pair of two.
The laugh track, I think it is unnecessary.
Oh, my goodness, it's an emergency. It's a good thing I'm a nurse.
I think that's due to, you know, a lot of the prehistoric thinking that goes on at networks.
The war can't last forever, Frank. They'll declare peace, and then where will I be?
There'll always be another war.
I think MASH is one show that could play well without it. It plays without it in England. All the operating room scenes play without a laugh track.
The laugh track in television is a carryover from the laugh track, not the laugh track, but the response of a studio audience in a radio show. And television being the offspring of radio, I think that's one of the unfortunate carryovers.
And we had tried very hard to persuade the network, it's Gelbart and myself, to abandon the laugh track. And so they went to, they tested. And however they test a thing like that. But their test showed that the audience appreciated the show just as much without the laugh track. And then you may ask, understandably, well, then why have a laugh track? And so I can only say that they feel more secure with a comedy show with the track.
This is a room in Korea.
It's ironic that just a few months after CBS decided to stick with the laugh track, they allowed Reynolds and Gelbart to produce an entire show without a laugh track. It's become MASH's most famous episode, The Interview.
At the last minute, CBS said, give us one more show. And Larry and I were out at the ranch on location. And I don't know if I was directing or not, but we were both out there. And I said, well, we've got to think about a 24th show and we have very little time. So Larry said, remember that we had looked at this Murrow. Murrow had gone to Korea, interviewed soldiers, Australians, Americans. And he had done a marvelous documentary on Korea during the war, and we had seen it years after. And he said, when you saw that show, you said, we ought to do that. We ought to have some guy come into the camp and interview all these people.
I've been asking if something special is coming out of this in the way of medical or technical developments.
Oh, there are some things that get a practical trying out here that maybe wouldn't with the same speed back home, but when you counterbalance that with the frightful expense, the frightful destruction and loss of life, I don't think it's an equal balance.
Well, do you see anything good coming out of this?
Not a damn thing.
And right there, I tore the back off of a script, took a blank piece of paper, and I said, let's try to think of questions that we can put to the actors and give them tape recorders and let them respond to the questions.
I know it's a first and probably a last for network television comedy or even drama, in that there wasn't a script until after we delivered the film. So I think of it as a terrific vote of confidence, you know, but it was an act of faith, I think, on the part of the network.
We wrote out about 20 questions. You know, why do you think you're here? What are you going to do when you get home? Who's responsible for all of this? What hurts the most? What do you like about it? Are you a better man for being here? Who do you miss the most? Has this whole thing been a waste? Whatever. And so these actors went off and they answered in character.
What do you feel was the most difficult thing you had to adjust to over here?
I think it's that everything is painted green. The clothes are green. The food is green, except the vegetables, of course. The only thing that's not green is the blood. The blood is red, if that's what you get the most of here.
Well, the almost criminal lack of respect, of military respect and discipline.
Well, some say that's too much to expect of doctors.
I don't see any harm in doctors being ordered to behave as patriotically as possible.
Well, doesn't patriotism have to come from the heart?
I don't have that problem.
So Larry went through and cut and added and changed and made his usual brilliant contribution.
Cleet Roberts, who played the interviewer, I gave him some questions, which he asked them on camera for the first time, and they responded.
You call it a police action back home, right? Over here, it's a war. A police action sounds like we're over here arresting people, handing out parking tickets. War is just killing, that's all.
Has this whole experience changed you in any way?
Certainly not.
There was no laugh track on that show.
No.
When I first came here, I couldn't walk down a corridor full of wounded people without being sickened by it, and now I can walk down without noticing them.
When the doctors cut into a patient, and it's cold, you know, why it is now, today, steam rises from the body. And the doctor will warm himself over the open wound. Could anyone look on that and not feel changed?
On occasion, major rewriting is done as a result of suggestions from the cast. One example of that was on a show called Preventative Medicine.
The story dealt essentially with a gung-ho officer who was overcommitted to taking ground, resulting in too many casualties. And we were angry about this. He came into the camp, and the idea was that we were going to team up, and we were going to get him, give him a Mickey,
yeah,
get him sick, tell him he had to have an appendectomy, take out his appendix, and ship him back to Tokyo.
Where does that hurt? Here? There.
Oh, boy. Bad case of gastritis. Probably lay you up a couple days.
Have you ever had your appendix out?
No. Appendix?
Yeah, acute appendicitis. That could keep you out for a week or two.
2 weeks? Oh, they'll take me off the line. I'll lose my battalion.
Definitely your appendix.
It was against everything I stood for, BJ stood for as a doctor, and against everything that I understood that doctors are to stand for.
And wouldn't it make a good scene to be that passionate and animated over that very point in the show?
You're a doctor of medicine. You cut into a healthy body, and you're going to hate yourself for the rest of your life.
I hate myself right now. I hate me, and I hate you, and I hate this whole life here. And if I can keep that maniac off the line by a simple appendectomy, I'll be able to hate myself with a clear conscience.
All right, you want to play God, you do it alone.
Fine. If you're going to keep talking about it, put a mask on. I don't want to run the slightest risk of infecting you. I agreed it was wrong, but I felt that the characters were under such stress that my character would do it because he felt that it was the only way to save dozens or hundreds of lives.
So?
was pink and perfect, and I tossed it in the scrap bucket. At least he won't be sending us any customers for a while.
Uh-huh. Radar was just in here. In about 10 minutes, they're sending us a batch of wounded.
10 minutes?
Attention, attention, all personnel.
Time flies.
Sorry, folks. Triage in the compound. Looks kind of heavy.
You treated a symptom. The disease goes merrily on. Let me point out that this didn't come out of whole cloth. This is came out of the research we did.
And the interesting thing is the real doctors who really did take out the appendix never argued about it when in real life. They just went ahead and did it. But it was important to take Mike's position and play out that soul-searching in a heated way. And it gave us one of the best scenes we had all season because we used something real that happened among the real actors.
Frank! What are you doing?
Burning book.
From the beginning, the actors on MASH have been able to develop their roles using the strength of their own personalities to guide the growth of their characters. There was one exception, however, Major Frank Burns.
The life of Red Grange?
Revolutionaries.
Why? Robinson Crusoe?
Everybody runs around half naked.
Norman Mailer.
It's got that word in it.
Well, I think that Larry Linville had a very difficult job playing a character that is not Larry, really.
We saddled Larry with a very narrow sort of point of view for a character. I might be just saying that because I had, you know, 4 years of it, and perhaps I was getting tired of dealing with the character.
And I ordered you to clean up that unholy mess in there, and if you don't, I will.
To a very large degree, Frank was a technical contrivance. He was, as a protagonist, had to create situations constantly whereby other characters would capitalize on his actions, you know, resulting in a funny line or a funny bit, you know, play a joke on Frank.
Gonna do a little cutting, Frank?
Well, as long as I'm there, I thought I'd go after the appendix. That's not the appendix, Frank. That's my pinky, and I'm very fond of it.
Oh.
It's a gag candle.
Well, why can't people leave us alone?
Hey, you think they were all my wife?
You can't define roles as how much fame you get or how much you're paid or whatever. If you can stand back and look at something like Frank, which is a very peculiar creation.
Forget that I said that. I did not.
And say, yes, that was successful, and yes, that did work, and yes, that was good. And if you take pride in that, then that's satisfying. That's good.
Someone sawn through these legs!
There's pudding in the pillow.
Oh, I'm gonna get that! For this, I'll get them off. Each and every day!
Exit Frank Burns. Enter Major Charles Emerson Winchester III.
You'll be making gravel at Leavenworth. Comprendi?
Comprendo.
Good. Well, Major... Oh, shit, I forgot.
David Ogden Stiers was spotted by Burt Metcalf while playing the role of the station manager on the Mary Tyler Moore Show.
His view of what... of that sort of behavior on Mary was lovably unlovable, that's in quotes, that I could really be a despicable person and a bastard to people who were loved and managed not to be so hateable myself that you didn't want to see the character again. And he thought that would be useful in terms of this show. He was wrong.
Raise your Continental down 7 points.
Who are they playing?
A major financial loss is hardly a laughing matter.
What they wanted in the Winchester character was a more formidable adversary for Hawkeye, almost a William F. Buckley type. Unlike Frank, Charles is a multidimensional character. His response to a given situation can't always be predicted, like the time Hawkeye had a hot date and needed someone to take his duty.
Charles! Sorry. OD? OD is a duty. I've already done mine. Weekend's your turn.
Look, I'll take all your duty for the next 3 days if you'll just work this weekend.
I hate working weekends.
What difference does it make? Every day's a holiday in Korea.
It's just the thought.
I'll let you use my aftershave.
Kerosene makes me break out.
Money?
Sorry.
Charles, you don't understand. This woman, she...
All right, all right. I'm giving in merely because I can use a 3-day vacation from you. Now, please don't get the idea that I'm doing it because I'm generous, or worse, amiable.
Trust me, no one will ever think of you as anything but completely rotten.
Coming in, there's that initial worry that a show that's been very popular and very strong is going to take a dive because suddenly you've joined it. Farrell went through that fear when he came in after Wayne left. The ratings went into the toilet for like 5-6 weeks or so, and he assumed that it was on his shoulders.
My concern was just generally, well, what if because of a lousy lead-in show or a lousy time or a lousy night or something, the show fails? What if people get tired of MASH? What if they hate me? You know, whatever the reason, if the show is canceled in his fourth year, my career is over because everybody will say that guy sank MASH single-handedly. At least that's what I thought.
And the same thing happened when I joined. The only worries I had were essentially invented and ignoring the fact that these people are consummate pros and wouldn't put you through awfulness, you know, to join. Does that answer?
Yeah. They have since put you through a little bit.
A little, yeah.
You care to...
You saw the room, Michael. You saw my dressing room. Well, I'll tell you. When I came back from Thanksgiving, some of the actors had contacted the paint department. And as a joke, they painted my room orange and purple. It will be repainted.
And repaid?
No, just repainted. And I'm planning on using Farrell's mustache.
Let's take her with us.
Jump.
Babies love jeep rides.
Leave her be, you lunatic. She's just now dozing off.
Don't rile them, Beach. You know how crazy they get when they're nursing.
How close in personality is Hawkeye Pierce and Alan Alda?
I don't know. Not very. He's a part of my personality. We've met over the years. You know, we've met each other halfway. I'm not a womanizer, and I never have been. I don't drink as much as he does, and I'm not as much of a smart aleck as he is. So there are a lot of ways in which we're different. But I think you have to draw on your own personality a lot if you're going to do a half hour a week. And yet you also need to have a strong character that you can fall back on if you're going to find stories that come out of that character.
BJ, it's Radar!
What did I do to him?
You didn't do anything to her. Hit by mortar fire.
His chest all right?
I don't know. Look around in there. Get him in there and prep it, Mark.
We were working out a scene in a show, and we said that, well, we better not have them drink because they're going into surgery. You know, we don't want to go into surgery drunk. And I said, you know, that's something we've never dealt with. How do they know sometimes that they're going into surgery? Or suppose we actually deal with that, that even if they do know they're going into surgery, they drink too much, or one of them drinks too much. And then I began to figure out that Hawkeye, what was the reason he drank too much? And it was because he was guilty about sending Radar off, and the Radar got wounded, and then he drank too much, and then he wasn't detoxified by the time surgery came around again the next morning, so he had to leave surgery to throw up.
You walked out on a patient, and Major Winchester had it finished for you.
So? I'd have done the same for him if he was sick.
Well, a lot of people don't look at it like you were sick, Hawkeye. A lot of people look up to you here. They admire you, and they kind of feel like they want to be like you. Gee, when you walk out on an operation, well, they kind of feel like you let them down. If they can't depend on you, well, they figure, well, maybe there's no point in depending on anything.
How dare you! The hell with your Iowa naivete, and the hell with your hero worship and your teddy bear, and while you're at it, the hell with you. Why don't you grow up, for crying out loud?
I just left Radar. Now, Hawkeye, please accept this in the spirit intended. You're under enormous pressure here, and I just want to know one little thing. Have you lost your mind?
Bob, you don't know how sorry I am.
I mean, that boy is lying there in a hospital bed with tubes sticking out of his body, and you call him a ninny?
Father?
I'm incensed. I am outraged.
Where's your decency, man? Your humanity. I'm acrimonious. I'm not a man given to physical demonstrations of emotion. But let me tell you, I am persuaded to violence.
Go ahead, Father.
Well, I think I will.
I'm glad you let it out, Father.
Well, I sometimes like to think the MASH is about a priest in Korea, but actually it's about doctors. But it could be about a priest in Korea. There are a lot of great stories about the chaplaincy, and a chaplain could be a protagonist of a show. It wouldn't have the... I know that the networks insist on a certain amount of female-male relations, sex, as it's called. And that might be... I did have one little brief romance, but that, of course, was not one in which Mulcahy was allowed to respond.
Religion is is more sensitive than violence. It's more sensitive than sex. You have to be extremely careful. And we have tried to do that. We've tried to have a rounded character in a man who is a man who is naive and innocent and very decent and fragile, but he's a very good priest. He's a decent man. I think we've done right by him, but perhaps not enough.
Graham, get out of here.
What's going on, Father?
Shh. He's exhausted.
Okay. Where's the guy that exhausted him?
Let me take care of it. Please?
I'm not even Catholic.
Would you like to be?
Action.
You know, you're being much too harsh on yourself. You mustn't think that you failed.
But I have no magic words.
Okay, now, David, bring your baby.
From the conception of an idea to its being broadcast on the air may take anywhere from 2 to 3 months. Out of those 2 or 3 months, the director is involved for 7 days.
One rehearsal from the moment of David's rise, just for positions. Okay, David, get up. So just check for all problems and move to your off position.
He comes to prepare for 2 days, he rehearses a day, and he shoots for 3 or 4 days, and then he leaves.
While in many episodes the director may just be trying to fulfill the intention of the writers, there are some episodes where he does more than that, where it really becomes his show. Such was the case with Point of View.
A very good script about a man who was shot in the throat, couldn't talk, and everything took place through his eyes, even from before the impact of the bullet.
The sergeant still tells us to spread out. So take a couple giant steps, Fergie. Incoming! Hit the deck!
Research is always to be very honest and let the audience concentrate on the story. So it was just using my imagination and thinking, what would I do if I were that veteran? What would things look like to me?
All right, just hold still. Big cheese, chin up. Okay, guys.
Okay, let's go. Move it. I got the whole senior class to do.
Sir, I'll have it developed in no time.
And sometimes when things were painful, I had the camera just move away and let the eyes or the lens look at something else over there. And sometimes I had him nod in an attempt to say yes rather than just write what he felt. It was fun to do.
This crazy bastard's got a live grenade!
Stan is a fine film editor. He worked on the pilot, and it's just a matter of appreciating the experience and the talent and the judgment that he has. We're blessed to have Tischler on the show from the beginning.
Don't blame me, old surly surgeon.
A foot and a half of film lasts a second. So you know how long a piece of film like this would last. And these are little things that I've taken out of the show on cut to cut just to make it play properly. So every detail is taken care of in the show. It's meticulously ironed out before it goes on the air.
Too late now. Just don't do it next time.
Do you give a wild line on 12? we put out a show in about 6 working days, average. Thanks. After you've got a show that's good, now you've got to say, okay, we are 3 minutes long. Now, without hurting the show, you've got to take 3 minutes out of the show, which, you know, it's got to hurt you personally, but it's still keeping the show as perfect as we possibly can.
One of the really unique things about MASH is its ability to take people from hilarious laughter to tears in a fraction of a second. How do you do it?
MASH works that way. Our audience, I think, expects it. They know what they're seeing when they turn the show on. It is so well written and so well acted and directed that we can just squeeze emotions out of people.
There's been a rash of practical jokes lately. Rank makes no difference. No one is safe from the mad joker.
What's in the box?
It's the ambulance driver's personal effects, sir. It's going out to Graves registration.
Did you write a little note for me to his folks?
Yes, sir. It's right here.
I never know what to say. Of all the lousy duties I've had to perform in this service, that's always been the lousiest.
Well, you can change it if you want, sir. I'm not sure all the words are exactly right or anything.
Dear Mr. and Mrs. O'Donnell, it is with real deep sadness that I must tell you of the death of your son. You can be very, very proud of Jerry. He never took a human life, and he died while he was trying to save the lives of 5 other fellows. He was rushing them to the EVAC, which is short for evacuation hospital in Seoul, when his ambulance overturned. He was a real good boy, Mr. and Mrs. O'Donnell, and I know he loved you both very much. He spoke of you often to my company clerk, Corporal Walter O'Reilly. We were proud of him at MASH, and we'll miss Jerry very, very much. Thank you, Radar. Don't change a word.
Thank you, sir.
I get a lot of letters from people thanking us for making them laugh and cry at the same time. To me, that's the best kind of drama, because that's what life is. Life is enjoying it and wondering how you're going to get through the next minute.
I bet I can guess what it is. Give me a hint.
Curiosity KO'd the feline clinger. I'd keep that.
I'd take note of that.
I'd take
no. Not nose, note.
That was such a good rehearsal.
Do it again.
How has MASH been able to survive changes in producers, writers, cast, directors, and still thrive?
It's amazing, isn't it? It really is remarkable. I would say one thing is the format. It is a remarkable format. It is these brave men and women in this little cockpit, in this specific locale, in a war situation, people who are extremely articulate. They are there against their will, and they cannot leave as they wish. Their work is futile. It's a perfect existential situation in which their whole goal is to heal people, to make them well and healthy and keep them together, and the overall goal of the project is to destroy life. So that format is marvelous. And then we've been very lucky, basically, with our cast. I mean, Alan has been with us throughout. I guess Jamie and Loretta and Bill are the only others, and we've been able to hold on to them.
Yeah.
I don't think that the show could have survived the loss of Alan Alda. I think Alan Alda is a marvelous guy to have in first position because Alan sets the tone.
Alan backed up a little more than you.
Aside from Alda's leadership, the management skills of Gene Reynolds helped keep MASH on course. For example, Reynolds instituted regular gripe sessions, described here by Jamie Farr.
We used to have these meetings. If anybody was unhappy, we would call a meeting of the cast and production. We would get into a circle. Maybe we better wait. They're shooting at it. For example, if we felt that we were being mistreated by the front office for some reason, or if one actor had a gripe about another actor, or if we thought that we as a unit were not really fulfilling our jobs, we would call a meeting and sit around and complain. It was closed door. The crew didn't know what was going on. And you were free, just like on the Senate floor, to call each other names, to get it out of your system. But the most important thing was to get it resolved.
See, what happens here is this organization that has been put together by whomever is now operated by Bert and Alan and the bunch of us. has become a community of kind of mutual support where people say, I said, hey, I'd like to direct an episode. This is the beginning of my fourth year here. And Bert said, yeah, I think you should. Instead of, oh, geez, you know, do we have to? It was, yeah, that's a good idea. And the understanding is I'm an intelligent guy, and if I get in trouble, Alan's there, and Harry's there, and Bert's there, and, you know, all the other people. And it worked, so now I'm directing more. And I said, I had an idea for a script, and they said, terrific, let's talk about it. And we talked about it, and they said, well, do you want to write it alone, or do you want to write it with us? And I said, I want to write with you, I'm scared. Because the writing in MASH is a very high-quality thing. And they said, well, what, write the outline. So I said, okay, and I wrote the outline, and I came in, and they said, that's terrific, now write the first draft. So I went home and wrote the first draft and brought it back in. They said, that's terrific, now do this, and write the second draft. I wrote the script myself. But it's because of a willingness on their part to accept the notion of an actor being more than a person who stands and hits the marks and says words, and of a kind of desire to draw out of us all that which we can contribute.
Let's go now.
Wait a minute, wait a second. Look, you know what it's like in this war. You've been in it all your life. You know, you've been out there. You know, listen, don't you read the papers?
Listen to him, he knows.
We had a seminar at UCLA, and a kid got up and said, why doesn't the network learn? They've got this example. Why don't they see that this is the way to do it? Well, it's very much like a batter is going up to bat at a crucial time in a ball game, and the manager calls him over and whispers in his ear, triple to left. I mean, they look at something that's successful, and you don't have to suggest to them copy. I mean, that's all they do is copy.
It's like finding a wonderful book and then deciding you're going to duplicate it and then copying the jacket. You know, they say, well, let's see, they have 5 or 7 or 8 people and so many men and so many women, and they're in that situation. Let's duplicate that.
And whatever you do, don't pick up any snipers.
And cut. And print.
You know what, Charlie?
What?
After I pushed that thing in there, Jamie closed the door, so he had to be in front of us.
That's what I said. We'll do one more.
Sorry.
Don't print.
You think television has learned anything from MASH? By television, I mean the networks?
I don't think they learn anything from anything. I really don't. I don't think they know how to do it again.
Well, listen, they didn't learn lessons from Mary Tyler Moore. Mary Tyler Moore was an extraordinarily human show. How could you have that and then some of the other stuff that you have that's just people shaking their cans at you?
I think, unfortunately, you have too many commercial barriers within the system as we know it. Networks just don't want to take the chances. I think probably if MASH were a pilot.
Action!
Thanks for the buggy ride.
Jane, start walking immediately, darling.
What's going on here? Open house?
You know, the only pain you're going to feel is when you find out that I don't know the rest of this line.
Somebody give him a hand.
No, stay where you are. My nose is coming out again.
Klinger, the signpost shows how much we miss our folks, how far we are from where we really want to be. All right, then, my parents can't come.
What?
Wait a minute.
What?
Why?
Forgot.
Action. Keep it moving. I checked the nurse's diagnosis. Well, I did. Keep it moving. I checked the dirt. Keep it moving. I checked the nurse's diagnosis. They can handle it. Let's get inside.
And we cut.